Hi and welcome. We're so excited that you chose to join us today. And we hope that this message will inspire you to live the life that God designed you to live. For this message or others like it, you can go to our website or you can find us on our YouTube channel. Now sit back, relax, enjoy this message.
Have your Bibles. I'll invite you to open them up with me to Romans chapter 1. I'm going to talk to you about something that I usually don't talk about. In fact, this is my first attempt at it. So you are in a record or groundbreaking situation here. I'm telling you that right now. I'm going to talk to you about resolving conflict in relationships. And the reason I don't talk about that much is because I don't think I'm that good at it. So I'm a little bit better at creating conflict in relationships than I am at resolving it. So I want to talk about how to create conflict in relationships, but I don't know if we need work on that. Do we need work on that? I don't think so. I think we need work on how to resolve conflict in relationships. And so I titled this message, Fight the Good Fight. You might recognize that verse from Timothy, Fight the Good Fight of Faith. But I dropped the word faith. I just said fight the good fight. So there's different ways that people can fight in situations, in relationships. And I just want you to be able to, when you are in a relationship, and we'll probably be focusing a lot on marriage, but it works for every relationship, how to resolve the conflict. You know, sometimes it's easy to throw a relationship away. When I was younger, I basically wanted to be right. Anytime I was in conflict, I wanted to be right, no matter what. Are you guys that way? I don't know if you guys, maybe you guys aren't that way. But I always wanted to be right. I would argue, even when I was wrong, I'd argue. And so what happened, though, is a lot of times is that you destroy relationships when you do that, when you're unreasonable, you don't value relationships. Now, there's a lot of different situations that I won't be addressing here, because some of you might be thinking, well, what about this? Well, what about that? And so I'm going to try to take a wide swipe right down the middle, and there are peripheral issues that I won't be talking about. And so, but I'm going to talk about some general things. The easiest answer, I think, when you deal with relationship conflict is just to tell people you need to love each other. You know, just say that, love each other. And, but I don't know, sometimes Christians need a little bit more breakdown on that statement, love each other. And so that's what we're going to try to talk about this morning, talking about how to resolve conflict in relationships, fight the good fight. First thing I want you to realize is that you have to be the type of person that values relationships. You got to be the type of person that values relationships. So what that means is that if you can just throw a relationship away quickly, you got to realize that's not God's heart. Because God doesn't throw relationships with us away quickly. In fact, when you think about it, relationships mean a lot to God. Amen? I mean, when you look at what he did to establish us in a relationship with himself, you can see that relationships mean a lot to God. And that's the basis of Christianity. In fact, I like simple things, and Christianity is defined by that one word, relationship. Relationship with God and relationship with people. It's the first and most important commandment, love God, Love people. That's basically it. So it breaks down to that. And what is that all about? It's all about relationships. You know, some people, they stay at home. They don't go to church. They stay at home and they watch TV preachers and they think that they can become complete by staying at home watching TV preachers. You cannot. Thank you for your enthusiasm. You cannot stay at home and watch TV preachers. I watch TV preachers all the time. I'm not saying it's wrong to watch TV preachers. I watch them all the time. I listen to all kinds of podcasts, CDs all the time. But I'm just saying that you can't be complete, because here's the Bible says that by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. The word baptized means to be immersed. And so what God does is God wants you to be immersed in a body. That means, and when that, what that is that means you're supposed to have healthy relationships with people in that body. And so you can't be complete without it, because I tell people this all the time, God made you a body part. You say, I don't want to be a body part. Tough. I didn't write it. God wrote it. He said, we have many members in one body. All the members don't have the same function. So you being many are one body in Christ, and members in particular, in one place that said members one of another. And so what that means is you're a part. You're a finger, you're an elbow, you're a forearm, you're an ear, you're something. And so, I mean, if you say, well, if the ear stays home on Sunday and watches TV, or listens, I suppose he'd be listening to TV preachers, then the body is missing an ear, right? Thank you for your enthusiasm. Isn't that right? And so, but some people say, well, but if I come, it's so painful because there's that person I don't like there. And they drive me crazy. I hate the way they say amen in church. Or where they say, praise the Lord. I just hate it, where they lift up their little hand and hold it up there, and they just bug the daylights out of me, right? The pastor drives me crazy. I can hardly stand the guy, which that's hard to believe. I know that's true, but what I'm saying is that you can't be complete because you're out of your design. That's not the way God designed it. The way God designed it is that we would be a body of believers in a New Testament Christian community. We'd actually be a community of believers, and that we'd be so much in love with each other, hard to believe, that the Bible says that the world would look at that and say, I know you're disciples of Christ because of your love for each other. That's what he said. That would be the overlying, defining mark of all Christians, is that they have love one for another. Well, if you're going to have that kind of a relationship with people, and I realize there's toxic people and you have to, you know, there's certain things you have to do sometimes, and I'm not addressing that right now, but I'm just going down the middle of the road here. But you're going to have to learn to deal with conflict, is what I'm trying to say. And conflict is very difficult, but I want you to, first of all, realize that God paid this incredible price for you to have a relationship with him. So God values relationships. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, it says this, that God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He demonstrated, this was his act in such a way that we would be able to be brought into a relationship, a vital relationship with him. The Bible says that he put away our sins by his own sacrifice. Why? So that we could have access to him through the blood of Jesus. He put away our sins. He canceled our sins. And actually, the Bible tells us that he gave us his righteousness. There's an Old Testament verse where Isaiah said, their righteousness, which means right standing, their righteousness is from me. It comes from me. So that's why when we talked about the armor of God last week, where it talks about the breastplate of righteousness, it's not your righteousness, because then it would be your armor. But it's God's righteousness. It's God's armor. So he says to put on God's armor, which is God's righteousness. In Romans chapter 5, it calls righteousness a gift. You don't earn a gift. You don't work for a gift. You receive a gift. So when you receive Christ, you become righteous. And that's as righteous as you'll ever be. Now, you can be more, there's things you can work on, but as God helps you, but you can't be any more righteous once you receive Christ, because you receive a gift of righteousness. From that point on, think about it. From that point on, God deals with you as if you're a righteous person. So God provided that when Jesus Christ died. He provided that access. So he paid, God paid an incredible price, so that he could have a relationship with you. I think you ought to tell your neighbor that. God paid an incredible price that he could have a relationship with you. I think that's a good thing to tell your neighbor. And so to us, relationships have to mean as much to us as they do to God. Amen. Now, there's certain things, like I said, that all relationships, now, when I say all, some people will protest and say, I should say most relationships have in common, or that it's inevitable, and that is there's going to be conflict. And it's like those verses where Jesus said, in the world, you're going to have tribulation. Then he said, be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. Jesus said to the disciples, offenses will come. So there's going to be opportunities for you to be offended. They're going to come. You don't have to accept them. And really, how you handle conflict determines where your relationship will go. Either it'll get stronger or it'll get weaker. I remember years ago, I used to live in California when I was a high school student with my parents. And my dad used to take me, we lived by San Francisco, my dad used to take me to L.A. He did business there. And this is back in the late 60s. And so we would go to L.A., and I would spend the whole day at Knott's Berry Farm all by myself. Just, you know, I don't know if you ever heard of Knott's Berry Farm. And it's famous for jelly, I guess, but I wasn't sampling the jelly. I was sampling other things. But anyway, so my dad would do business calls. Then he'd say, I'll pick you up at 5. So then at 5 o'clock, he'd pick me up. And I was just like 13, 14 years old. You probably wouldn't do that today. He'd pick me up. But here's the thing I remember about it, is that we'd go to L.A. and there's so much smog that my eyes would be burning. I'd walk around, my eyes are just burning. You look, you see this filthy mist in the air, this filthy, huge cloud that would hang over the city. They say that they've gotten rid of 90% of that smog now. But at that time, it was so thick, it was actually harmful to your health. And so when rain would come, it was always a welcome thing, because what the rain would do, it was begin to purify the air. A good, healthy fight, remember, fight the good fight. A good, healthy fight, I'm going to describe that in a minute, actually can clear the air, so to speak, in your relationship. A good, healthy one. Obviously, an unhealthy one will create more smog, right? But a good, healthy one can create some really good things. You can actually grow, your relationship can grow healthier, richer, and more intimate. Surveys say that the average married couple argues about small nagging things 312 times per year. That's like every day, three quarters of the day out of the year. That's more than every other day. They say the average couple, now not big things, but small things. How many know that little things can drive you crazy? I mean, just little things. Why do you do that? I mean, you know, you ever do that? Why do you do that? You want to hear some of our arguments, our fights? I think that when you drive your car, there's three positions your car is in. Number one is acceleration. Second one is applying the brakes. I don't think of a good word for that. Deceleration or braking. And the third one is coasting. Let me tell you something. Coasting's a good thing. Coasting is a good thing. Anticipating the stop sign. My wife is listening now. We're arguing right now, but she can't tell her side. Coasting is a good thing. I think coasting is a good thing. So in other words, when you see a stop sign up there a ways, you don't keep the gas on until you have to slam on the brake, right? I mean, sometimes we get off the off ramp on the interstate and we're going 65 miles an hour, and she steps on the gas going up the thing, and then you got to slam on the brakes, and we're almost, everybody's flying forward. Why didn't you coast? It's not, it's not how we drive, right? It's, let up on it, coast, apply the brakes smoothly. We don't get nip neck issues, right? How many know what I mean? That's one of our arguments. You can ask my wife. You want to hear one of my really bad, I think I might have told you this one, really bad arguments? We were having this argument once. I probably shouldn't tell you it. You guys want to hear it? Okay, so we had this. All right, you want to tell you, and I don't want to. My wife has her side of the story, and I'm only telling my side, so it's not really fair to her. But we had this argument about Christmas cards one year, and they didn't get sent out or something, and so I was upset, and so we were arguing back and forth, and she was driving, and I was writing something, or I can't remember. And so we're arguing. I'm going, we bought all these Christmas cards. I was going on and on and on. And so she got mad at me. So she put in a gospel worship tape. She put it in, and then she turned it up as loud as it can go. And we had all the kids in the car because she didn't want to hear me anymore. So you know what I did? I just began to worship the Lord. And we resolved that conflict right there. I just began to worship. No, I ejected it and threw it out the window. So, yeah. Talk about being transparent. Now, what the kids thought, they were in the car and they witnessed this whole thing. And they thought I had threw God out the window. And they were like, oh, you threw God. They were... You know, it was a bad, bad, bad scene. But it got quiet after that. But anyway, so the question is not in most cases will you have conflict, it's what is gonna happen. They say the difference between a happy couple and a not so happy couple is usually determined by how they fight. Interesting, right? You know, it's interesting. If you read the New Testament, I don't know if you've noticed this, but Paul calls people animals. He gives them animal names. Like one place he said, I fought with wild beasts at Ephesus. And he's not talking about fighting with a lion or a natural animal. If you read the account of when he went to Ephesus, you can see what happened. The whole city went in an uproar. He said, I fought with wild beasts. He's talking about people that act like animals. He said, another place, he said, beware of dogs. He's not going like, watch out for the dog, you know, like a beware of dog sign, you know, beware of dog. No, he's talking about people in the church that are, or people that are, act like animals. How many know that that can happen sometimes? People can have the morals of an animal. They just go around sniffing everything and laying with everybody. They can have the morals of an animal, right? And so you have to be careful when you deal with stuff. He said, beware, don't bite and devour one another. There's a lot of references to animal-type natures or animal-type activity among humans. And we think about this. Humans were made on the sixth day. You read Genesis account. And so were people made on the sixth day. And so some people say that we evolved from monkeys and that type of stuff. That's really not true. It's really baloney. But the thing about it, because the difference between us and animals is the fact that we, when God made animals, he spoke to the earth and said, let the earth bring forth. But when he made man, he spoke to himself and he said, let us bring forth. And then he formed man out of the dust of the ground. And then the thing that animals don't have that we have is it says he breathed into their nostrils the breath of life and man became a living being, living soul. And so we have a dimension that the animals don't have. They don't have spirits. They don't have spirits. We have spirits. And so we have a dimension that they don't have. And with that spirit, we can contact God. And so, but the problem is, if we don't live, the Bible tells us to walk in the Spirit. If we don't walk in the Spirit, we'll become like animals and we'll bite and devour each other. How many know what I mean? And so there's a way that you can have conflict and you can do it with the permission or the blessing of the Holy Spirit in God, and that it can resolve and actually can cause you to grow deeper in your relationship with each other. There's an interesting verse in Romans chapter 1 and verse 26. It says this, and this is out of the Message Bible. It says, worse followed. This is the Message Bible, so it's kind of modern English. Refusing to know God, they soon didn't know how to be human either. Women didn't know how to be women, and men didn't know how to be men. So notice he says here, refusing to know God, they stopped knowing how to be human. They're not even acting like humans anymore. They're deteriorating to such an extent That the picture, when you look at them in conflict, it looks more like an animal, two animals, than it does look like two humans. They're just, rah, rah, you know, rah, rah. And I've had to referee some of these conflicts at times, and then they start swearing at each other. And I'm going, now wait a second, we are Christians, right? I mean, come on, you know, and it's not pretty. But what happens is a lot of it is built up stuff that needs to be resolved. Amen. So bad fighting, here's some things about bad fighting. Are you still with me? Are you shocked that I'm preaching on this? Okay. I thought you looked shocked. Like, or you're guilty. Maybe that's a guilty look. Well, I told you some of my laundry, so, you know, I'm just... Bad fighting is where one person attacks the other person. There's name-calling, belittling. It escalates. There's defensiveness, rehearsing of old issues, outward displays of animosity, like, but I won't go into that. But anyways, so you can see that it's kind of a real negative thing. Good fighting is where there is respect, there's cooperation, there's understanding, there's empathy. Empathy, I found out, is a really big word. It's an important word. Easing of tension, resolving of issues, and there's actually growth in intimacy. So we're not saying we ignore the conflict, but we're talking about how we're going to handle it. We're not just going to ignore issues. Sometimes people have issues, but they never talk about them. I heard this one story one time where two married couples, they got married, and they got mad at each other, and they wouldn't talk to each other. It went on for a long time. And so the husband had to get up in the morning. The wife was an early riser, and the husband had trouble getting up. And so he left the wife a note at night when he went to bed. Please wake me up at 5 o'clock or 5:30. Now, they're giving each other the silent treatment. And so he wrote her a note. He wouldn't communicate to her. He just communicated with a note. And then he goes to bed. He wakes up. It's 9 a.m. He's supposed to get up at 5:30 or something. He gets up, and he's going to yell at his wife, but he's giving her the silent treatment. But he's going to let her have it. And he looks over by his nightstand there and said, wake up. It's 5:30. There's a note. Well, for communicating in notes, she wakes up, puts a note by her nightstand, it's 5:30, wake up. I would say that's bad fighting. Amen? So handling conflict well actually deepens our relationship. Amen. So happily married couples, listen to this, they see themselves as allies, not adversaries. We're allies. We're in this together. We're going to work this out together. We're going to lock arms. We're going to deal with issues, but we're going to make this happen. 93% of the couples that fight bad will be divorced within 10 years. That's the statistics. So that means all fights are not equal. They fight bad. I'm not saying they have conflict, but they fight bad. So that's why researchers can predict now that 94%, with 94% accuracy, if a couple will stay together just based on how they fight. Because after a while, you know, how many know this is true? That the Bible says that love covers a multitude of sins. Love lets things go. But if you never let something go, what happens is it just keeps building. And the air inside your relationship becomes more and more toxic, more and more smog, more and more smog, until finally there's something extreme that happens. And so it's very important that we deal with issues and we do it in the right way. You know, the Bible says that, and I'm going to skip over some things here, and so we don't have to deal with all things, but I want you to know that relationships very often can bring out the very worst in a person. And especially if you have issues in your life, issues that from your past when you're growing up, that it's like an issue buried alive, it never dies. It becomes a landmine for all future relationships. I heard this preacher illustrate this one time. He said, it's sort of like if you go to Chuck E. Cheese, which I don't go there anymore. Thank God. But but anyways, yeah, some of you are looking at me like, oh, I still got to go there. But anyway, but they have this game there where it's this thing where things pop up and you're supposed to hit it. How many ever seen that? I don't know what they call it. What is it called? Whack-a-mole? Whack-a-mole. So you're sitting there with a hammer or something, I can't remember what it is, and you wait, and all of a sudden something, you hit it. You know, and so you got to do that. And I don't know what the point of the game is, but anyways, but I guess maybe it's if you're having a lot of conflict. Maybe they put it at Chuck E. Cheese because you're the parent and you're there and you're so frustrated that you have to eat at Chuck E. Cheese and be there that you go over to the whack-a-mole and you whack-a-mole. Maybe that's it. I don't know what it is. But my point is that's how it is when there's issues in our life that are buried alive. In other words, they never were dealt with. You never dealt with it. What happens is in future relationships, it pops up. And there it is. It becomes a landmine in your future relationship. Now let's talk about some of the issues that affect us in relationship. The first one I want to talk about is shame. Everybody say shame. Shame. Now we used to have a saying when I was a kid, you know, we used to say, or our mother, somebody would say, shame on you. Have you ever heard that? Listen, shame is very destructive. There's a difference between guilt and shame. We'll talk about that in just a second. But shame is really, really unhealthy. And when shame is in a person's life, it's very difficult to have a good relationship with that person. Because the shame prevents you from having a good relationship. It's like having baggage that is going to hinder your future relationships. And so it's destructive. It's defiling. When shame is at work, we feel, here's some words that describe you, how you feel when shame is at work, to identify if shame's working in our life. You feel devalued, you feel dishonored, you feel disfigured, disgraced, disconnected, disillusioned, dissatisfied, disapproved, disrespected. Shame is debilitating. You don't want to go anywhere, you don't want to meet people. Why? Because shame works there. You'll think that this person won't like me, won't accept me. So shame is the result of the things that we have done and cannot forgive ourselves. Or here's the other thing. Shame comes when someone else did something to us and that we can't get past it. Or we need something that we should have had growing up. It's like, in other words, if you didn't get love and acceptance from your parents, if you didn't get identity, value, acceptance from your parents, shame will work in your life. And what happens then, it creates a difficulty for you to have normal, natural relationships with anybody. Amen? And so it's not just you did something, you can't forgive yourself. That's the most common way we think shame comes. And it does come that way. But it also comes when somebody does something to you, whether it's like molestation or something in your past, hurtful situation. Somebody did something to you, and you can't get past it. I mean, how many know that we all go through bad things in our life? I mean, you might not even get home today without somebody. Well, of course, you probably wouldn't have a traffic issue out here, but I don't know, maybe a deer will run across your road and flick a rock into your windshield or something. I don't know. Something will happen. But it doesn't mean just because something bad happened that you have shame. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying you know usually if an issue is not dealt with, it's not over with, because it still hounds you, it still affects you, it still affects your relationships. You feel when you get around somebody else, you feel inferior, you feel like you're not normal, you feel like you don't fit in, you're disconnected, you don't feel like you're accepted. Those are shame issues. And so that means when a person is suffering from shame and they get into a relationship, what happens is they usually become very touchy. And so you can say, are we going to wash the dishes? All of a sudden, the wife just goes crazy, starts screaming at you. You're like, you go, what's up? Are you trying to say I'm a bad wife? I'm going, are we going to wash the dishes? You know, it's like this overreaction over something simple. Or you say something like, she tries something on and she shows it to you. And you go, does this look good on me? And you say, yeah, it looks all right. I mean, I'm a worse one with fashion. I'll tell you that right now. I can tell if it looks terrible, but I can't tell you other than that. You can tell by the way I dress. I'm not a fashion guy. But anyway, and then all of a sudden you go, yeah, that's all right. Then she just goes crazy, starts yelling at you. You go, what's up? And she's thinking that you're thinking I'm spending too much money on clothes. And I'm going, I didn't say that. I mean, you're just like, what is going on here? But when shame is working, there's always an overreaction to an issue. How many can see what I'm saying? And so think about those. If you have things that you can't forgive yourself over, or things that you feel, this is an issue in my life that I just can't get past. And you have to fight. And the Bible says that Jesus went to the cross despising shame. You got to hate shame. You got to despise it. You got to act up against it, because it should have no place in your life. Amen? Thank you for your enthusiasm. See, in Genesis chapter 3, this is where shame came into the world. Genesis 3:7, it says, at that moment, this is the New Living Translation, at that moment their eyes were open. This is right after they ate, Adam and Eve. Their eyes were open and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. This is the very first time man experienced shame. It's like an over-awareness of yourself. You walk into a room, you kind of feel awkward, you kind of feel like you stick out. You can't be yourself. You think people are looking at you, talking about you. Those are all shame-based attitudes. So they sew fig leaves together to cover their nakedness. And then later it says they were fearful. So shame actually works with fear. Fear and shame. If you're a fearful person, it could very well you have a lot of shame. And so here's the difference between shame and guilt. Guilt is actually a good thing as long as it doesn't last. In other words, you deal with it. Guilt means that your conscience is working. When you do something wrong, you should feel guilty. If you do something wrong, you don't feel guilty, your conscience ain't working. But you shouldn't hang on to guilt. You should release it. Once you receive forgiveness for it, let it go. Like that song, let it go. Some of you are probably wondering, what are you talking about? There's a song that says, let it go. And I don't know the rest of the song, but I think a lot of it's let it go, right? Let it go. Forgive yourself and let it go. Should I keep singing? So guilt says, I thought you needed a comedy break there. You're looking pretty serious. Guilt says I did something wrong. Shame says I am something wrong. So come, we can see the difference. Guilt said I did something wrong. Shame says I am something wrong. There's something deeply wrong with me. But guilt says, I did what when I threw that tape out of the window, there's something deeply wrong, not with me, but with that act. That was not good, okay? Because it was littering. I shouldn't say that. I could probably get charged. I'm digging myself a hole here. Anyway, so guilt says, I made a mistake. Shame says, I am a mistake. How many can see that? Guilt can be healthy if it's short-lived. Shame is deeply defiling that eats away at your life like a cancer. Shame makes it difficult to have healthy, normal relationships. Amen? See, it's interesting. Another thing that shame does is that you blame others. The very first thing that Adam did after he was... Interesting, when God came to him and said, did you eat of the tree? Did you eat of the tree? What did he say? Yes, I did. I take full responsibility for my actions. Is that what he said? What did he say? The woman that you gave me. It wasn't even the woman. And it's one thing, it was just the woman, oh, my wife. You know, it wasn't just that. It was the woman you gave me. You are ultimately responsible because you gave me this woman. So I don't know who to blame, but it ain't me. It's the woman or you. One of you two have to take full responsibility for the fact that I chowed on that apple. That's usually a shame-based way of thinking, right? And so that's what happens when people are suffering. So they suffer from blame. They become a victim. They don't own up to what they did. They shift blame because it is threatening to their sense of value or self-worth. They won't take responsibility for what they've done. You know, it's interesting when you look at, I saw this one time in a book where it talked about the four things that are important for a healthy conflict resolution. And they're the words, the acronym CORE, C-O-R-E. The first one is cooperation. You have to approach this from the standpoint that we're going to cooperate. We're going to get through this together. So the first one is cooperation. The second one is ownership. I'm going to own what I did. I'm letting that sink in. Because if I say, no, it's all you, I am totally, totally, totally without blame. I mean, not even a little beep blame. It's totally you, or it's totally, right? That's not owning what you did. Thank you for your enthusiasm. The third thing is respect, C-O-R. And the last one is empathy. You know, I heard this when we were taking this marriage thing, and I've been trying to do this lately, is empathy is try to think what that person is going through. Like with my wife, I don't know if I did this much, but my wife had five kids and four boys, and they were boys. I mean, boy, oh boy, oh boy, were they boys. And one sweetheart daughter, lovely girl, sweeter than honey, awesome young lady, woman of God, beautiful. But four mongrels. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just joking. I mean, you want to hear a funny story? One time, we kept, you know how you have couches and seats in your house, and they always have on the armrest, they have covers. You know, they had put a cover on there or whatever. Well, one of the boys was finding it in his loving nature to cut these covers up. They'd take a scissor. I'd find the scissor, and I'd find the cover. They're all cut up. And I kept asking, who did it? And they're all just standing there looking at me. I know one of you did it. No, who is it? So I got this brilliant idea that I would trick them into confessing. So the next time it happened, I said, all right. I called them all in there. I said, all right. It happened again. Now, whoever did it, your fingerprints are on this scissor. So I'm going to take this into the police department, and I'm going to have the fingerprints run, and I'm going to find out which one of you did it. And so who did it? I'm trying to get them to confess. They wouldn't confess. So I took a plastic bag, and I went over there with tweezers, and I picked up the scissors, and I put them in the plastic bag. And I said, I'm not kidding. I'm bringing this into the police station. You better confess. And you know what happened? After that, they kept asking me, hey, did you bring those scissors? Every one of them. When are you going to bring them scissors in? So that whole scheme backfired. You know, the whole thing backfired. I don't know why I told you that story. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, so my wife, that's right, that's my wife. So she had all these kids. And I just never, you know, I'd come home and I go, why is the house isn't clean? She'd be like, I'm going to kill you, you know. But I learned fast how to clean house, wash dishes, cook, and do laundry. I learned fast how to do that because my wife had her hands full. Not that I wasn't there, too, telling her what to do. This kid needs this. No, I'm joking. I'm totally joking. Some of you don't think it's funny, but anyways. He's a monster. He's a monster. Why am I listening to him? So, you know, you think about it, it's so important that we deal with shame. So here's the thing. If you go, I have shame, I think I have shame, don't let it stay. Find a way to deal with it. You know, the answer to sin is the reason shame came into the world, so the answer to it is what Jesus did. Amen? So here's the thing. The opposite of shame is this, glory and honor. The opposite of shame is glory and honor. There's a verse in Hebrews chapter 2. It says in verse 6 and 7, New Living Translation says, what are mere mortals that you should think about them? Or a son of man that you should care for him? Yet for a little while you made him a little lower than the angels, and you crowned him with glory and honor. Notice it says that in the beginning, God crowned man with glory and honor. See, we always want that back. Because we lost it in the fall. We lost glory and honor. God destined that we would be crowned with glory and honor. Glory and honor is dignity and worth. That's another word for it. Dignity and worth has to do with value. That we'd walk around feeling that we have value, that there's a kingliness about us. There's an excellence about us. There's a dignity about us. God intended for you to walk around that. Around that way. God never intended for you to have inferiority and to shrink back in the face of anything, but that you'd be bold and you'd be confident, that you would live out your destiny. the way God intended for you to do it. Amen? Let's have the worship team come up. I was going to go into another thing here, but I think I'm going to close. So if shame came into the world because of sin and transgression, the remedy is the salvation that we find in Jesus Christ. Amen? It doesn't matter what you've gone through. There is an answer for your situation. How many got anything out of that today? We're going to talk about another aspect of next week. I remember one time, I'll tell you this, this story while the worship team gets ready. Years ago, this lady called me. This is like 20 years ago, so it's not any of you. This lady called me, and she goes, "My husband is crazy." I go, "Okay. He is absolutely nuts. He threatened me with a knife. He throws stuff down the stairway. He broke the door down. He threatened my son with a hammer." Now, if you got a call like that, what would you think? You think, this is serious. You've got to talk to him. He is absolutely out of his mind. So I go, okay. So I hang up. And I call him up. I say, "Hey, how's it going?" He goes, "Good. Yeah, great, actually." I go, okay. I mean, what I just heard described, you are one step away from the loon. You should be locked up. You should be tethered to a wall somewhere with Prozac, you know, coming in, going in every vein and every eating Prozac like it's M&M's or something. I mean, come on. He goes, "Oh, great, great. So how's things at home?" "Good, yeah, really good." I'm just trying to beat around the bush because I didn't really get permission from her to tell him that she called me. I didn't get that permission. So I was trying to just let him open up the can of worms, you know. And so I'm just sitting there asking probing questions. "Well, what about this?" "That's great. Yeah, everything's wonderful." I'm going, "Well, I'm not talking to the madman of Gadara, that's for sure. I don't know." And so finally I go, "Well, let me just be honest. The reason I call is your wife called me. This is what she said. She said you threatened her with a knife, threw the bills down the stairs, you broke the door down, and you threatened the son with a hammer." He goes, "Well, let me give you another twist on that story." He goes, "Well, I was paying bills, and we started arguing about the bills. And I had a letter opener in my hand because I was opening up the bills. And so I'm talking to her, the letter opener in my hands, and I'm saying, 'You can't spend money we don't have.'" And he's saying that to her. She gets mad, grabs the bills, throws them down the stairs. So he goes, "Would you pick those up, please? I'm going to go out and get the rest of the mail, or get the mail to see if there's any more bills. I want to pay all the bills." So when he goes outside, she locks the door. And it was cold out. I don't know if it was winter. And he didn't put a coat on because he was just going to go get the mail and come back. So when he comes back, the door's locked. So he's pounding on the window saying, "Please open the door." And she's going, "No." And so then he goes, "I'm freezing out here. Please open the door." And so then he's trying to get the kids' attention so they will go open the door. And she's saying, "Leave him alone. Let him suffer." So finally, he's getting so cold, he's almost blue. So he has to go over and he has to break the door, the little garage door down, so he can get in the house and get some warm. And so then he asked one of the sons to come and help him put the door back on. So he had a hammer in his hand. And he's going, "Why didn't you open the door?" And that's the scene of threatening the son with the hammer. So how many can see that that's a little bit of a different perspective? But that's how arguments are, aren't they? You got your story, she's got her story. And somewhere in the middle, somewhere, the truth be told. Or sometimes the truth is never told. Amen? So did you get anything out of that? I guess I already asked that. Let's all stand together. It's not really my type of sermon, but next week I'm going to talk about the second part of this. And I got a lot of good stories about you know who. Then I was going to say, maybe I should have her, give her 10 minutes to rebut. I need a 10-minute rebuttal over this thing here. Let's just sing this song.
Walking around these walls. faithful, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness, oh God, I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me.
Confidence, you never fail me.
your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail, yeah. Oh, never fail me, yeah. I won't forget. You never fail me yet.
Say, Lord, I appreciate you so much. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Just declare, God, you're working in my life. Just say that. God, you're working in my life. Say, God, you're working in my relationships. Come on, just say that out loud. God, you're working in my relationships. Say that out loud. I believe you're working, Lord. You're removing obstacles. Just say that. Lord, you're removing obstacles in my relationships. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Praise God. You know, I just had this flash across my spirit that seems like there's somebody here. Maybe you feel like this is the last, I'm at the end of my rope, so to speak. I can't go on or I can't deal with this anymore. Something like that. And I'm going to give you the opportunity to be prayed for. I just want to encourage you. If that's you, just please come forward and receive prayer. If I identified this message about shame, if I identified anything, issues that you might have, please come and receive prayer. The prayer counselors, if you guys could please come forward and just allow yourself to be prayed for. You know, everybody needs, I tell this all the time, but everybody needs prayer. If you say, I don't have anything to pray about, pray for me. And I'll take it. But everybody needs prayer from time to time. But if you feel like, you know, I've struggled with this issue for so long, I can't get rid of it. You feel like it maybe takes something more than just a quick prayer. You know, amazing thing about it, you should call the church and we can make an appointment. But the thing about it is that the answer is not necessarily rehashing all that stuff because it doesn't do any good. Is the Spirit of God. The Bible talks about how the Holy Spirit goes into the innermost parts of our being. And it can take the scriptures, the word, and cut out anything that is holding you back. God loves you so much. He paid an incredible price for you to return to glory and honor. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In other words, the thing that God ordained, we've all fallen short of it. But then it says, but that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There's life, eternal life, that would flood your soul if you open up, let things go. If you open up. Sometimes we hang on to stuff because it's almost like a security blanket. It's like, it's been so much pain over this issue, I can't let it go because it's my identity almost. You've got to let it go. There's a new identity God has for you. It's a son and a daughter. God wants you to be his son. God wants you to be his daughter. Amen? Let me tell you this right now. God takes good care of his sons and daughters. He really does. It's amazing. And that's your identity, a son, a daughter. Jesus came, died. He was the only begotten son. He gave his life after the cross. Jesus is never referred to as the only begotten son of God again. He's referred to as the first begotten. From that point on, he's the first begotten. It says he's the first begotten of many brethren. That means there's many like him to follow. Amen? Why? Because of what he did. Before the cross, he was the only begotten son. After the cross, he's the first begotten. So that means your number's there too. It might be 5,000,007 or something. But if you receive Christ, you're a begotten. And when he looks at you, he says, you are my beloved son. You're my beloved daughter. In you, I'm well pleased. Isn't that awesome? And so if you need prayer, please come forward. If you have a spiritual need, you've never surrendered your life to Christ, this would be a good time to do it. Just ask somebody to pray for you. Tell them where you're at. Does that sound good? So as soon as I dismiss, please come forward and have one of these counselors, prayer counselors, pray for you. Praise God. Lord, thank you for your people. Pray your blessing be upon them and upon their relationships, their families, their children, Lord. Give them an awesome week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. You're free to go. If you need prayer, please come forward. Join us for some fellowship out in the back.
Spirit heat around us. Let there